a new booster development at Massey's, a tank arrival at Sanchez, ongoing work inside Megabay 2 at the build site, and Pad B tower base rises. These and much more in this week's Starbase Flyover Review, episode 46. Hey, I'm Jeff A, and I'll be your guide today. Sit down, strap in, and let's get started over at Massey's. Beginning at the flame trench, we finally have our first look inside the business end of the trench. We can see things look largely untouched after Ship 26 conducted its 6 engine static fire, apart from some minor damage to the slurry wall on the right side. Nearby, we can see the flame trench stand has been staged near the trench after it was moved to the front of the site, so that they could remove Ship 26 and place it on a transport stand and then roll it back to the rocket garden. Moving to the LOX tank farm area, we can see work is progressing with the foundations for 2 additional LOX tanks, with rebar and steel embeds being placed in preparation for concrete. Next, the old can crusher cap has been removed from B14.1. Looking closely, we can see test sensors mounted at various locations around the article indicating testing has occurred. It's unclear if it will be used for future testing, so be sure to tune into upcoming episodes to find out. Moving down to the new structural test stand, we can see the third level has been stacked, with parts for a fourth level sitting nearby. At the GSC platform, we can see stairs have been installed for accessibility to the top. An unknown temporary machine has been placed on the top level. Below the nose cone jail, a new 10-sided mystery structure sits. The Nelson studs on the inner and outer surfaces indicate it will be filled with concrete. It also bears resemblance to the centre base of the booster cryo stand, so it is likely to be the centre of the new structural test rig. The most interesting thing about this part is the provision of 5 centre actuators. Could this be the new layout for the upcoming 35 engine booster, as mentioned in the EIS from the new Kennedy report? Thanks to the space engineer for creating this render of what the engine layout might look like in more detail. Ryan Hansen has also posted this render on X as a possibility. With that, let's move over to Sanchez. Before we start, let's have a quick look at the map to get your bearings. As always, let's start at the GSC building, where pipes are being fabricated for upgrades to the launch site tank farm. As you can see here, some smaller pipes that are usually used to manage gases, and this big one for the main LOX delivery side for the new 2 incoming tanks. Again, not much work has been done in the transport stand construction area since the last flyover, although it is expected to ramp up soon as many boosters will start to be moved around for testing. To the right, these items were moved here to start constructing a similar circle-shaped structure that we have seen in the past, along with what looks like another rectangle-like structure that we expect to be for Star Factory. Further to the right, the horizontal directional boring in front of the Starbase sign that we saw in the past few weeks is now finished. At the tower section staging area, a new tank has appeared. This should be one of 2 for the launch site LOX farm expansion. Recently prefabricated plumbing is staged here ahead of installation on the new tower, speeding up the construction process by several weeks. Sections 4 and 5 are the only ones remaining to arrive at Starbase. Both of them, along with the chopstick system, are on their way to the port of Brownsville. The barge is expected to arrive on June 23rd. Finally, at the rocket garden, the little ship that could is back again. Ship 26 was transported from Massey's static fire test stand on June 12th. Its future is now uncertain. Tell us what you think in the comments. Now let's roll over to the build site. Let's first look at a labelled map thanks to Brocky. First looking at Megabay 2, where work on starships hasn't resumed, though work to outfit this bay continues. In the centre, we see continued work on the access platforms being installed. In the entrance, we see concrete truck offloading into a pump truck, likely placing the poured deck surface on the platforms on the right side of the bay. To the side of the bay, as well as in front, we see a new shipment of white beams and columns have arrived. We are likely to see these being used to continue the work access around the left side of the bay. Moving to Megabay 1, we were treated to wide open doors and can see B12 here in the back left. The lack of chines suggests that it's still some time before this booster is ready for static fire testing. In the centre, we see Booster 13. Shifting just a bit more, we can see Booster 14 in the back right corner, as well as the LOX tank for B15, which stands 12 rings tall. Just to the left outside of the doorway, we can see the next section of this booster being prepared for stacking. Meanwhile, the high bay is the scene of repairs. In the back right is Ship 31, which has been prepared for a second attempt at cryo testing. In the front right, ship 30, after having one of its RVAC engines replaced, is now being stripped of all its heat shield tiles. Following the tile failures of ship 29 during IFT4, Elon indicated that the entire heat shield would be removed and replaced with a newer tile design, as well as an updated underlay with ablative properties in an effort to compensate for tiles that may become damaged during flight. Behind the Star Factory, utility work continues. We see that concrete has been poured over the areas where drainage was being installed recently. Along the retention wall, we see two pipelines being installed. These are likely water main feeds that should supply the office building. If we move further right, we see the directional drilling machine at work. The two pipes staged along St. Martin for many weeks now are being pulled underground with the drill. One which its end is protruding from the excavation, and the second is currently being pulled into place. Taking a quick look at the factory, we can see all of the holes except one used for bridge crane installation have been patched up. Zooming into the footings for the front extension of the factory, we now see that the factory and office will in fact connect to one another. The open end at the front section has a new temporary door put up. The framework of the office building seems to be coming quickly to an end, as the tallest wings now appear to have its fifth floor decking laid with only the roof panels to be spread out. On the ground floor, we see that the concrete was poured here the day of the flyover. Swinging over to the shorter wing, it appears only a couple of beams remain to be installed. At the junction of the taller part of the building, we see that this section stands the full height of the building that may serve as the main entrance. With no noticeable changes in the village, let's head over to the launch site. Here's the latest labelled map. We'll start our tour at Orbital Pad B. Let's first compare this week's progress to the flyover of June 6th. Looking at this week's progress, we can see the completed pile cap having been filled with 181 concrete truckloads on the evening of June 9th, continuing well into June 10th. As well as finishing the pile cap, they had raised two of the steel base legs that can be seen here. Later in the day, following the flyover, these legs were connected to a beam across the top and the first wall section, seen nearby with the other panels, was slid into the space between them. In this clip from Labpadre, we can see the remaining two legs being set on their embeds. Looking around a bit further, we can see those two last legs laying on their sides. Further from the tower foundation are additional steel wall segments that should complete the four walls between the legs. Further structures for the winch house around the back of the tower have not yet arrived. To the bottom of the tower in this image, the CFA drill rig continues work placing piles for surrounding pad structures. With tower progress coming along nicely, this week also brought us views of the crane that will stack the tower segments. SpaceX has chosen the Terex DMAG CC8800-1 with boom booster main boom for the job. The crane has a maximum lifting capacity of 1,600 metric tons, compared to the 1,350 metric tons of the LR11-350, used to stack the first tower at Boca Chica and at LC39A in Florida. We see that the crawler carrier is assembled and crews had begun assembling the superstructure that includes the cab and winches for operation. To the right of the SpaceX LR11000, the yellow derrick segments are staged and were installed on June 16th. One unique element of this crane is the boom booster main section that must be built on site from pieces delivered in containers. We see here one of the end adapters complete with the second being assembled. These transition from the standard boom sections that will be above and below the large sections yet to be assembled. Next to this assembly area, we see that the well point dewatering system is installed and water can be seen pumped from this location. It remains a mystery what this area will be used for. Let us know in the comments what this space may be for. Moving nearby, we can see that crews continue to remove concrete and other debris that was beneath the suborbital tank farm, with soil being staged on the opposite side of what remains of the berm. Along the container wall next to Starhopper, we see that part of the storage building and panels of the containers have been removed. Speculation is that this may be to move the location of Gate D2 due to the continued tank expansion. Or perhaps they just want to replace the container wall with the concrete retaining wall that has been installed at other places along Highway 4. Speaking of tank farm expansion, we can see that the foundations for the two additional tanks have been fully excavated and filled back in with concrete and steel embed plates, similar to the newest LOX tanks at Massey's. Work continues around the remaining vertical tanks with vac trucks continuing to remove the perlite. On the afternoon of June 16th, the LR11000, or Marvin, made its way over to start the final scrapping operations of these three tanks. It was later hooked up to GSEC-4, which protected the GSE-3 LOX tank. We can also see around the perimeter of these tanks that the main LOX supply piping has been removed. Over at the control bunker, we can see that some electrical upgrades are being performed, with several transformers being moved in and out of the area in recent days. Moving over to Pad A, we see the booster clamp arms extended with the clamps wrapped in blue covers. This clip, again courtesy of Labpadre and captured by Vix, shows some of the 10 hold-down clamps that were seen replaced. We can also see the booster alignment pins have been reinstalled. And finally, we will take a close look at the chopsticks, supporting Elon's comments suggesting that Flight 5 will include a booster catch attempt. Crews have once again begun working on the catch rails that haven't seen work in quite some time. In this image, we can see the pushers have travelled to the respective ends of the landing rail so that crews can test the lifting and lowering of these rails in preparation for the first catch attempt. That's it for episode 46 of Starbase Flyer Review. Thank you for choosing to fly with RGV Aerial Photography, and I hope you all enjoyed the flight. If you liked what you saw today, please subscribe for more episodes and content so you don't miss out on the new videos each week, and leave a thumbs up on the way out. To receive the latest images and to join in the conversations on the day they are taken, please consider joining RGV's Patreon. I'm Jeff A, and I'll see you next week from 10,500 feet.